Well, amen. Good to see you all here this morning. Boy, what a great day it's been thus far. And we had a great time at the 10 o'clock hour. Enjoyed just a wonderful concert by Master's Promise. And we're celebrating 29 years of God's blessings here at Lighthouse Baptist. Appreciate you joining with us here this morning. We're going to go ahead and at this time, I'm going to ask for Master's Promise. You all maybe have a seat. Go ahead and have a seat. We're going to have Master's Promise sing a song for us. And we enjoyed them in the 10 o'clock hour. And they're going to sing one for us here in just a moment. And then we're going to spend a few more moments. Let's go ahead and let's give them a hand once again as they come and sing for us.
Church feels a stirring as we're seeing the signs. So much to accomplish, not a moment to lose. We must remain faithful in all that we do.
Sing our theme song for this year, Bow the Knee. Let's sing it out on that verse. What a privilege to come into God's presence.
What a privilege to come into God's presence, just to linger with the one who set me free. As I lift my eyes and see his awesome glory, I remember who he is and bow.
Sing it out with me.
Bow the knee. Bow the knee. He is King of all the ages. Bow the knee. God alone.
we thank you so much for the privilege, Lord, to come before you. Lord, we truly bow our knee before you. You're worthy of our worship, our praise, our surrendered life unto you. Lord, I pray that you would just be glorified. Lord, we thank you for the privilege to be able to come together and to worship you. Lord, to be able to hear from you. And I pray, Lord, you'd speak to our hearts today. Allow for your spirit, Lord, I pray, to have free reign in this place. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. We're going to have Master's Promise come back and sing a couple of songs for us at this time.
Angels were assembled before the throne, singing songs of worship to the Lord alone, as they cried, "Holy, holy," the heavens filled with glory. But they had to step aside when they heard a song. It made the Father smile to see his child step forth and start to sing. Redeemed, I am redeemed. The greatest song this mortal tongue can sing. Redeemed,
I am redeemed. Then I shall bow in humble hands.
Ladies, come back and sing for us once again.
Come, but the blessed.
the hill that was pierced by the cross. It caught the blood that fell. It bore the weight of the sins of the world, and the Son of God as well. It heard the voice of the Lamb without blemish, and it shook as he cried, "It is finished." Calvary's cry has come to this place. Calvary's cry is still love and grace. 2,000 years
for that hill of redemption. I praise the Lord today to know that I'm a child of God. I'm on the way to heaven. It's not because of what good that I've done. It's because of what Jesus Christ has done for me. And if you're here today and you understand what I'm talking about, you've trusted in Christ as your Savior. What a wonderful privilege to know that you're on your way to heaven. I praise the Lord for that. I want you, if you would, take your Bibles this morning. Turn with me over to Matthew chapter 7. We've been looking through this passage of Scripture now for what's been several weeks. We're really about 20 weeks we've been looking at this, and we're looking at the greatest sermon that's ever been preached, not because I'm preaching it, but because Jesus Christ preached it. It's that Sermon on the Mount, and I'll tell you what, it was a wonderful message. We've been able to, you know, he preached it all in just a little bit of time in an afternoon. We've been taking 20 weeks to look at it because there's so much wonderful things here that we can learn from it. But I want you to look here today. We're to the getting near toward the end of that message that Jesus Christ preached there in chapter 7 of Matthew in verse number 13. I want you to notice it there if you would. Matthew chapter 7, look at verse number 13. Matthew chapter 7, verse number 13. God's word says there, "Enter ye in the straight gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it." Let's have a word of prayer. Lord, we're thankful today for that cry from Calvary. Lord, we're thankful for your mercy, your grace. Lord, it's not diminished one bit in 2,000 years. And Lord, it's still crying out today. Lord, I pray that we would hear it. I pray, Lord, that we might listen today. I pray, Lord, that today that each and every person here would hear that call. And Lord, if there are those here today that have never responded to that call, Lord, that they would today. They would come to know you as their personal Savior. Lord, speak to our hearts. Lord, we need you. Lord, I pray for your Holy Spirit. Lord, fill me with your power, your words. Lord, I pray the message that goes forth today would be the exact message that each of us needs to hear. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. On July 17th, 1938, there was a pilot. His name was Douglas Corrigan. Put a picture up there for you to look at. Nice looking young guy. Well, he got in this airplane. He was wanting to break a record. He was going to fly all the way from New York to California. As he got ready to fly that day, he got together there at the Brooklyn's Floyd Bennett Field, and he carried with him two chocolate bars, two boxes of fig bars, and a quart of water. Of course, he had his map with him, a U.S. map. Well, he got in that airplane that day, and it was called a Curtis Robin, modified, of course, to have more gas, and it was a foggy morning. He got up, and he flew up into the air, into the haze and the mist, and he disappeared. 28 hours he landed later. Not in California, though, but in Dublin, Ireland. He instantly became a national hero. Everybody was calling his name as being a hero. He did something that they thought could not be done. But his name was henceforth called Wrong Way Corrigan. He actually signed it in that picture, the Wrong Way Corrigan. Can you imagine being that lost? That'd be kind of scary. I mean, you're flying. I thought there was supposed to be land down there, and it's a lot of water, you know what I mean? I mean, you ever been lost while you're driving? You ever made a wrong turn? Oh, yeah. Amen? I've never done it myself. My wife has a few times, but yeah, right. Is my wife in here? Is she working with the Anna Special? Oh, there's... Oh, no, I can't even tell the story I was going to tell, but no, I'm just having fun. Well, I'll tell you, there was one time that we were driving, and we were supposed to be following the GPS, and, I better quit the story right there because Charity loves GPSs. But we, you know, every once in a while we take the wrong turn, don't we? Sometimes it costs you a little bit. You get a little bit off course and you might mess up a little bit. Sometimes you end up in some place you never thought you ever would end up. So thus far I've never ended up in Ireland, so I praise the Lord for that. I mean, that would be quite a ride. But, you know, as we see here that Jesus, he's nearing the end of his Sermon on the Mount. He talks about the danger of going the wrong way. And each person here, sitting here today with the sound of my voice, we literally are going either the right way or we're going the wrong way. Jesus Christ, he is trying to get us to look at which direction that we're headed, and he wants us to realize, hey, are you going the right way or the wrong way? And this message, as he's wrapping it up, he's wanting for the disciples that were there, the people that were there, as they were listening to the Sermon on the Mount, to ponder this question as well as every one of us as we read God's Word. This message, you know, he preached it many years ago, but it's for us today as well. He wants for us to determine, hey, are you going the right way or are you going the wrong way? You know, it all depends on using the analogy that Jesus gives us. You see, I'm so thankful that when God's Word challenges us with questions like that, he gives us the answer of how we can know that we're going the right way. And in the analogy that he uses here, he shows it to us. It's interesting, as Jesus comes down to this closing, he talks about a series of contrasts. He talks about two gates and two trees and two houses. Today I want for us just to focus in on these two gates. See, one is a very narrow, the other is a very broad way. One is a very popular gate, the other is only entered by a very few. And as we're going to see this morning, which one a person enters makes an eternal difference. It's going to determine your eternal destiny. So let's take a look at it today. Let's look at these two gates. I want us to draw three lessons that we can learn from these two gates today. First of all, the first lesson it reminds us of, number one, the division of all mankind. The division of all mankind. As Jesus Christ talked to these about these two gates, as he spoke to his disciples and those that were there, and he talked about these gates, he thought of all mankind literally being grouped in two separate groups. You know, we divide people in groups. We think of people in different social groups, different ethnicity. We think of people different color or social standing, maybe different educational groups. There's all kinds of groups that we see, and oftentimes we fill out forms. We have to mark these boxes. But when Jesus, when he came to dividing people, he used neither of these factors. What he used was he divided people based on spiritual standards. And we see the division of all mankind literally in these couple of words here in verses 13 and 14. We see the two words. I want you to focus in with me on them. The words many and the word few. The word many and the word few. You see, every person in this place, you either are part of the many or you're part of the few. Matter of fact, every person that's alive in the world today, they're either part of the many or they're part of the few. And as we look at the divisions of all mankind, I want you to notice the group that identifies, first of all, the word many, the group that Jesus is speaking about here. In this, we see this. We see those that have rejected Christ. Those that have rejected Jesus Christ. The many that Jesus spoke of are those who have never been saved, those who have never been born again, those who have never trusted in Jesus Christ alone for their salvation. You know, according to the world population clock, I looked it up yesterday, and the number, according to how many people are approximately living in the world today, is 7,190,036,686. That's a lot of people. Man, that's, you were talking about a lot of people. That number is just growing. You sit there and watch the clock, and that number just continues to grow and grow and grow. And the sad and tragic truth, and the fact is that the majority of those over 7 billion people are unsaved. They're lost. They don't have peace in their heart of knowing 100% sure that they're on their way to heaven. They're part of the many. They're part of the big group. They're headed in the wrong direction. And Jesus Christ, he's talking about this crowd. And you know, the crowd is made up of many kinds of people. There are many people that are part of this many. They're made up, first of all, of depraved people. People that would be part of this many group, the many of them are depraved. Among this crowd are those who favor the pleasures and the sins, and they follow the path of sin in their life. They desire to fulfill the lust of the flesh. You know, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 2 through 3, Paul, he spoke of those who walk according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind. Well, that's true, isn't it? Many people today, that's all they desire to do. They want to fulfill that lust. They're depraved people. We look at our society today, you look at the amount of money that's being spent on pornography. The numbers, a statistic that it wasn't that long ago, but they said over $10 billion is being spent annually on pornography. That's a lot of money, folks. People are spending money on all kinds of things that you would say, well, why would they spend so much money? How about this one? $128 billion was spent on alcoholic drinks last year. $128 billion. Our society is marked by indulgence. It's marked by sensuality. It's marked by immorality. You see, it is the course of the world in which we live, a course which is fulfilling the desires of the flesh, and it's very dominant. Many people, they fall into this category of depraved people. But you know, they're not the only one that's in that big group that Jesus talks about, the many. There's another crowd that we would call decent people that's in that group as well. Decent people. Not everyone in the crowd is a sin and pleasure crazy person. There are many that are in this majority that are good, that are honest, that are moral and decent people, as man would see it. They desire to be good neighbors. I mean, they desire to be a good worker. They're a hard worker on the job. They do all kinds of wonderful things for people, and they've got a good heart, it might seem, as far as man is concerned. They're decent people in that many. There's also, in the many, there's the crowd that's also made up of deceived people. Deceived people. You know, it may surprise you, but there are many that are in the crowd that's called the many, that's called this group, that's headed in the wrong direction, that are religious people. They're very religious. They do all kinds of religious things. And I classify them as being deceived because although they're religious, they're not saved. Although they're religious, they don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Although they do good things and they go through all the acts of religion, they still have been deceived and they're headed to hell. You say, how do we know this? Well, in just a few weeks, we're going to be looking at a couple of verses later. Jesus said in chapter 7, verse 21, look what he said. He says, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. They do many wonderful works. They say the Lord. They pray. They do all these things. And yet, he says, not everyone that does those things are going to go to heaven. See, even in this majority, even in this mass of people, even in this great crowd of people, the many, there are those that are religious and yet they're not saved. There are those who are headed in the wrong direction. Secondly, we see the second group Jesus speaks of. He speaks of the few. The few. We have the many. We have the few. In this, we see that those that have received Christ, they've received Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. And when we speak of the word few, it doesn't mean that there's only just a couple of people that have done that. It's talking about in comparison to the many. In comparison to the many in the world today that are headed in the wrong direction, that are headed literally to hell, that are headed to a separation from God for all eternity, there are but a small portion that are headed toward heaven. They're the few. That's a smaller number. You know, I'm thankful that I can say today that I'm part of the few. Amen. I'm thankful that I'm in that group. Now, let me just say this and be very sure that you hear this. It's not because I'm a good person. I desire to do good. But you know what? The Bible says there's none righteous, no, not one. Hey, listen, it's not because I've earned my place in heaven. Listen, I don't deserve heaven. The Bible says, for the wages of sin is death. If I got what I truly deserved, I'll tell you what, it wouldn't be heaven. It'd be hell. I'm part of the few, not because of anything or work that I've done, but it's because of what Jesus Christ did for me. And I trusted in Christ as my Savior. I became part of the few. Hey, listen, there was many years ago, I like that song. There's a song that says this, there was a time on earth when in the book of heaven, an old account was standing for sins yet unforgiven. My name was at the top and many things below. I went unto the keeper and I settled it long ago. I like that verse. Hey, there's another verse I like in that song. The old account was large and growing every day. For I was always sinning and never tried to pay. But when I looked ahead and saw such pain and woe, I said that I would settle, and I settled it long ago. Amen. I like the verse. Long ago, long ago. Yes, the old account was settled long ago. And the record's clear today, for he washed my sins away. When the old account was settled long ago. Hey, praise God. Hey, listen. Many years ago, I got down on my knees before God, and I'll tell you what I did. I repented of my sins. I realized that I was a sinner. I realized I deserved to die and go to hell. I realized I did not deserve heaven. I realized that if I did not get in the right way, I did not become part of the few, that I would die and go to heaven. And I turned toward God and I said, God, please forgive me of my sins. Have mercy upon me. I believe Jesus died for me. I believe that he rose again. I believe that you are God and that Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. And you know what he did that day? Hey, listen, he washed my sins away. My account was settled. He literally wrote at the top, paid in full. All my sin debt was covered with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. I became part of that few. Listen, once again, I want to remind you, it's not because of what I did. It's because of what Jesus Christ did on Calvary's cross. I praise God for that today. I want you to notice, secondly with me, not only did Jesus talk about a division of mankind, but also, number two, he talks about the decision of all of mankind. The decision of all of mankind. There's not only two crowds, but there's also two courses that people are taking. There's two different groups, and there's two different ways that people are going. The words there, enter ye, in verse number 13, it calls for a decision to be made on our part. Christ is trying, as he's preaching this message, he's trying now for people to get to the point where they must make a decision. He's drawing the net. He's drawing it down to a point. He's saying, enter ye. He's calling for a decision to be made on every person's part. And this decision is between two things. It's between the broad way and it's between the narrow way. In verse 13, the broad way, and the narrow way. In verse 14, he speaks of that. As I said earlier, every person here is either part of the many or is part of the few. As well, every person that is here, listen, you are either headed on the broad way or you are headed on the narrow way. I want for us to think about those two ways for a moment. And first, I want us to think about the broad way. In the broad way, we see this. We see an easy way. It's an easy way. It's not a hard way to go. It's the natural thing that man wants to do. It's the sinful thing, the natural sinful nature that man has. They just want to go and they don't want to do anything that's difficult. They want to go down the easy way. You know, practically every city has a name of a street called Broadway. I know they've got one down in Muskegon. There's actually a Broadway Baptist Church down there on Broadway, on street. But there's a lot of different Broadway streets. If you look around, and I've seen them in many different cities. But they talk about the easy way for travel. This way is a broad and easy way. Therefore, as Jesus said this, he says, many there be which go in thereat. It's just an easy thing to do. So many there be which go in thereat. It's the way of the majority. Or to put it another way, it's the way of this world. It's the way the world's headed. It's the way the people of this world are headed. And Jesus, he called this way the broad. He called it the wide way. And as a broad and wide way, it's open to everyone. It's open to anything. There's no restrictions on the broad way. It's open to the religious as well as the atheist. It's open to the moral as well as the immoral. It's open to the defiled as well as the decent. Whoever, whatever, is welcome on that broad way without any regulations or restrictions. There's no requirement to travel the broad way. You know, the Bible speaks of this broad way in Proverbs 14, verse 12, and chapter 16, verse 25. It says that there is a way that seemeth right unto men. It's that natural way that seems right unto men. It feels like the way to go. It's the easy thing to do. Whatever may seem right to one is welcome on the broad way. Hey, if you believe that way, I believe this way, it's okay. We can all walk together. It's okay. Everything is welcome on the broad way. You may feel that, hey, you have a different way of looking at it. That's okay. You know what? Literally, that's the way of the world. It's the way of the majority. It's politically correct. It's the easy way. It's the way that people are headed. You know, the other way that Jesus spoke of is totally opposite, though, of that way, of the world's way. Instead of being the broad way, it's a narrow way. And in the narrow way, we see an eternal way. An eternal way. Jesus, he describes this gate as being straight. He talks about this gate as being a narrow way. This gate is not without restrictions and requirements. There are some restrictions to go and to be part of the few. There are some restrictions to go through that narrow gate and go that narrow way. You see, being straight is restrictive. Being narrow has its requirements. You know, I call it an eternal way because it's God's way of salvation. God's way of salvation. You know, on the broad way, there are many different ideas and opinions of how to get to heaven. They say, well, hey, you can get to heaven this way, you can get to heaven that way. There are many different ideas on that broad way. On the broad way, one will tell you that if you do good things, if you try to be good enough, you can go to heaven. On the broad way, they'll tell you that if you can just be religious enough, you'll get to heaven. On the broad way, they say, hey, at the end, if you'll weigh out all the good things you've done, if it outweighs the bad things that you've done, you can go to heaven. On the broad way, you're told that we are all God's children. You know what? That's all of that right there is nothing but a lie from the devil. And there are so many people that are following after that. Yes, on this straight and narrow way, though, we're told that there is only one way to be saved, though. Jesus Christ, he said this in John 14, verse 6. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Jesus is the way. He is the only way to heaven. God's word tells us in Acts chapter 4, verse 12, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. It's through the name of Jesus Christ that people get saved. It is only through Jesus Christ that people can get saved. Hey, there is nobody else that we can go through. There is no other way that we can go through. It is through Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, he called himself the door in John chapter 10 and verse number 9. He's both the gate and the door to heaven. It's through him that we must go through in order to go to heaven. You know, in this gate we find Jesus' requirements for salvation. He talks about the straight. He talks about the narrow gate. He's been describing it and talking about it. You know, I've heard some people talk about the straight and the narrow gate as a turnstile. Something, you know, when you go into a football game, you've got to go through the turnstile and it lets one person in at a time. You could say that this narrow gate is very similar to that because, listen, you can't go in two by two. You cannot enter this narrow way. You cannot be part of the few two by two. You can't go in as a family. It's something that each individual person must enter themselves. Every person has to make the decision for themselves whether or not they're going to receive Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. Listen, you can't be born into the narrow way. You can't be born into a particular family and therefore you're on your way to heaven. You can't, listen, it's something that you must make as an individual. You must choose whether to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. Nobody can do that for you. Just because mom and dad got saved doesn't mean that you're saved. You have to make the choice. Just because grandpa and grandma are in heaven today doesn't mean that you're automatically headed there. You have to make a decision. You've got to decide. You've got to accept Jesus Christ. It's something that you go through. You do it personally. It's a gate that is personal. Now here's a decision facing all of mankind. Will you choose and take the broad way, or will you choose and take the narrow way? Which way are you going to go? Which decision will you make? The word enter in verse number 13 is a very interesting word. I want you to look at it. You see that in verse number 13? It says, enter ye in. Enter. The word enter in that verse there, it's the aorist imperative tense. And what that means is that it speaks of a definite and specific action on our part. It's a definite and specific decision that each and every one of us must make. We have to make that decision. We have to choose. By the way, a decision not to make a decision is still a decision. A decision not to accept Jesus Christ as our personal Savior is a decision to reject Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. And here Jesus, he is imploring us. Jesus is trying to get us to the point where we realize we have to make a decision. He's telling us to enter in. He's telling us to enter into the way that leads unto life and everlasting life. He's telling us to make the right decision. You know, we make a lot of decisions in life, don't we? You know, some people, they say, oh, I don't like to make the, you know, don't push me, don't pressure me to make a decision about this. You realize you make decisions every day? Every decision you make a decision about what time you're going to get up, about what you're going to eat, about what you're going to wear, about whether you're going to take a shower or not, amen? Some of you, never mind. All right, we make decisions every day, don't we? I mean, we make decisions on, you know, what time we're going to go to bed. We make all kinds of it. You know, and some decisions, they don't weigh that heavy in our life, do they? I mean, what I'm going to eat for lunch is not like a real weighty decision about the rest of my life, other than I might put a little few more pounds on. But, I mean, you know, I mean, it's not like a life-altering decision. What time I'm going to get up, whether it's 6 or 6:30, it's probably not going to change my life that much. Of course, unless I was supposed to be at work at 6, right? But listen, there are some decisions, though, that are so huge that they are not only this life altering, but they are for eternity altering. They're going to have an impact on the rest of your life. They're going to literally have an impact for all eternity. And this is the type of decision that we're talking about this morning. We're talking about a decision that is so important. Hey, listen, which gate will you enter? Which way will you take? Are you going to take the broad way or are you going to take the narrow way? You know, it's so important we make the right decision because the reason why the decision is so important, thirdly, is because the destination of all mankind. The destination of all mankind. There are two crowds, there are two choices, and there are two consequences. Yes, there is the narrow, there is the broad, there is the great, there's the few, there is the many, and there are also two consequences. There is heaven and there is hell. And it's all going to be determined by the decision that we make. Every person has to make a decision. How you decide determines your eternal destiny. And Jesus, he spoke about the broad way, which leads to destruction, is what he said. And he talked about the narrow way that leads to life. In closing, I want for us to think about these two destinations for a moment. I want you to try to imagine heaven and hell with me for a moment. I want you to think about them. You know, we like to go through life, and we don't like to think about negative things sometimes. We like to just, you know, think about all positive things. But you realize, listen, Jesus Christ, if you looked at the Bible, hell was mentioned 10 times more than heaven in the Bible. For every one time the Bible talks about heaven, it talks 10 times more about hell. Why? Because God doesn't want anybody to go there. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. He's wanting for everybody to go to heaven. For God so loved the world, that's everybody, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God loves you. God wants you to go to heaven. So God, here in his word, he's warning us about a destruction. He's saying, hey, don't go that way. Hey, go this way, because this leads to life. And so I want us to look at this. I want us to, first of all, as we think of this subject about the broad way, I want us to notice that it leads to a ruined life. A ruined life. That word, the destruction, it speaks of loss or that which is ruined. The broad way leads to spiritual ruin. And you know what? And ultimately, the consequence is eternity without God in a place called hell. It's being separated from God for all eternity. The Bible speaks of a man that died and went to hell. Jesus actually gave us these words. It's found in Luke chapter 16. It talks about the rich man. How the rich man, he lived in this life and he enjoyed all the things of this life and he had all the pleasures of this life. Now listen, being rich is not what sends a person to hell. Money is not the root of all evil. It's the love of money. Here this man was rich. He had all these things. He lived a sumptuous life and he had all the things that you could ever ask for, and yet he never at one time thought about his soul and where he'd spend eternity. And the Bible says that he died. And we see here in Luke chapter 16, verse 22, there when it says that he died, the rich man also died and was buried, and in hell he lift up his eyes being in torments. Plural. Hell is a horrific place. Hell is a place. You know, God, he tried to warn us in his word. He tries to describe his word. There are so many passages of scripture that talk about the horrors of hell. And here is a man that Jesus tells us of, that he lifts up his eyes in hell and he's in torments. He's literally being tormented day and night. He is in a terrible place. This is the destination, by the way, of all who choose to take the broad road. Of all those that just go the way that seems right to man, the end is death. It brings destruction. It causes them to end up in a place, listen, that nobody in their right mind would ever want to go. If we could get just a picture of what hell is like, nobody would want to go there. I once read a story about a man. His name was Archibald Boyle. He was a leading member of an association of the wild and wicked men known as the Hell Club in Glasgow, Scotland. Talk about a club to be part of. This was back over 100 years ago, the story is told. And after one night of carousing at the club's notorious annual meeting, Boyle went to bed and he began to dream. He dreamed that he was riding home on a black horse. And in the darkness, someone seized the reins and they shouted, "You must go with me." Well, as Boyle desperately tried to force the reins from the hands of the unknown guide, the horse reared up and Boyle fell down and down and down, increasing in speed. And he said, "Where are you taking me?" The cold voice replied, "To hell." The echoes of the groans and yells of the frantic people that were crying out, it began to ring in his ears. And at the entrance to hell, Boyle saw the inmates. They were chasing the same pleasures they had pursued in life. There was a lady that he'd known. There she was. She was playing her favorite vulgar game. Boyle relaxed. He thought to himself, hell must be pleasurable. It must be a wonderful place after all. But when he asked to rest for a moment and show him, he asked this lady to show him through the pleasures of hell. She shrieked, "There is no rest in hell. There is no rest in hell." She unclasped the vest that was robing her and opened it up and displayed there was a coil of living snakes that were withering inside of her and moving around in her midsection. Others revealed different forms of pain in their hearts as well. "Take me from this place," he said. "Oh, by the living God whose name I've so often outraged, I beg you, let me go." His guide replied, "Go then, but in a year and a day we meet to part no more." At this, Boyle woke up. feeling that these last words that were so horrible and so, heinous, he could not hardly think of them, but it caused him to literally have a burning within his heart. It just sunk down. It was something that scared him. Well, despite a resolution never to attend Hell Club again, he soon began to go back. He found no comfort there, though. He grew haggard. He grew gray under the weight of the conscience and fear of the future. He dreaded attending the club's annual meeting the following year, but his companions, they forced him to attend. They said, "You've got to go with us." Every nerve of his body, it was just totally in agony. And he thought, "Man, I'm this is horrible." As he sat there, in the very first sentence that was said there at that day, the president's opening address said this: "Gentlemen, this is a leap year, therefore it's a year and a day since the last annual meeting." He remembered those words from his dream. Well, the next morning, his horse was found grazing quietly by the roadside. A few yards away lay the corpse of Archibald Boyle. Can you imagine? Now, I'm not into dreams. I'm not into those things. But, you know, I believe that there are those that have fears. You know, there used to be a time in my life when I went to bed at night and I was afraid to go to sleep. I was afraid to lay my head down on that pillow for fear that if I died that I would go to hell in the night. I had a fear in my heart of not knowing for sure that I was going to heaven. Here is a man, the story goes, that he had this dream, and I'll tell you, listen, hey, every one of us, if we are completely honest with ourselves, if we don't know for sure where we'll go when we die, we ought to be afraid. It ought to worry us. It ought to concern us. Jesus said this in verse 13. He said, "Wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat." You see, it's the destination of a ruined life. How long is life? I mean, you think about it. I'm 44 years old. For some, I'm a young man. For some young people, I'm an old man. Right? But how old will I be when I die? When this body takes its last breath, you know, I don't know for sure. The Bible says it's appointed unto men once to die, and after this the judgment. I don't know how old I'll be, but one day I will die. I know that. The Bible also says, "Boast not thyself of the morrow, for thou knowest not what the day may bring." None of us are guaranteed tomorrow. We don't know we'll be here tomorrow. We don't know when we're going to take that last breath. Well, which way are you headed? Which direction are you going? Jesus, he speaks here about this broad way that leads to destruction. But you know, I'm thankful that he also speaks about a straight and narrow way. In the straight and narrow way, we see a redeemed life. Not a ruined life, but a redeemed life. Jesus said in verse 14, he said that the narrow way leadeth unto life. It leads to life. Let me ask you, what kind of life was Jesus talking about? What kind of life does he mean just in this life? No, listen. The Bible says in John 3, verse 15, he says that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. He was talking about a life that would go on and on and on forever in a place called heaven. Hey, listen, being with God for all eternity. That's the kind of life. He said in John chapter 10, verse 28, "And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand." That's a permanent thing, man. I'll tell you what, God is all powerful. And when I accepted Christ as my Savior, you know what he did? He held on to me and he said, "Hey, you're mine. Nobody could ever change that. Nobody could ever pluck me out of his hand." It's an eternal thing. It's an everlasting thing. That's that narrow way he's talking about. That's that few he's talking about. He's talking about those who've trusted in Christ as their Savior. They have everlasting life. And you know when it starts? The very moment you accepted Christ. I've got it right now. Hey, listen, if you're a child of God today, you've trusted in Christ, your Savior, you already have it. You already have eternal life. As sure as a million years from now, you have it today. Praise God for that. I'm thankful for the redeemed life that God has given to me. I'm thankful. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Hey, are you redeemed today? Say amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. It's so good to be part of the few, to be part of the redeemed life. You see, one road leads to destruction. One road leads to a ruined life. But the other leads to a redeemed life. I want to share this story with you. It's a true story about W.B. Henson, a great preacher of past generations. He said that just, he said these quotes just before he died. He shared these memories. He said, "I remember a year ago when a doctor came and told me that you have an illness for which you won't be able to recover. I knew that day that my life was going to be short. I knew that I was not going to be able to recover. I mean, he believed that God could answer prayer and heal him, but he believed that he was at rest. If the doctor said that he probably wouldn't recover, if it wasn't for a miracle of God, he probably would be dead soon. And he knew that." He went on to say, though, he says, "I walked out of there, and I live 5 miles from Portland, Oregon, and I looked across at the mountain that I love. I looked at the river in which I rejoice, and I looked at the stately trees that are always God's own poetry to my soul. And then in the evening, I looked up to that great sky where God was lighting his lamps, and I said, I may not see many more times those lights, but mountain, I shall be alive when you are gone. And river, I shall be alive when you cease running toward the sea. And stars, I shall be alive when you have fallen from your sockets in this universe." Amen. Well, I'll tell you what a great way to look at life. Hey, if you're a child of God, that's the way we look at things. Hey, you look around. These things are going to be gone one day, folks. One day, hey, listen, this world is going to be gone, in which we know. Hey, but listen, we're going to be forever with God. We have eternal life. Nothing could ever separate us from the love of God. Nothing could ever change the fact that we're on our way to heaven. Hey, I am redeemed. I'm on my way to heaven. Christ paid the price to set me free. Have you trusted in Christ as your Savior today? You see, the truth is, whether you are in heaven or hell for all eternity, is whether or not you have chosen the right path. You've chosen the right gate. Whether or not you are part of the many or you're part of the few. You know, for me, it's not a decision that I have to make anymore because I accepted Christ as my Savior. He guaranteed I have everlasting life. He guaranteed my salvation. I'm right there in the palm of his hand. I praise God that I have settled that long ago. I don't have to worry about it any longer. I don't have to worry when I go to bed whether or not I'm going to die through the night and go to heaven or hell. I know I'm on the way to heaven. Not because, once again, of what I've done, but because of what God has done for me and he's promised me in his word. Maybe you're here this morning. You've not made the decision to be part of the few. You've not made the decision to trust in Christ alone as your personal Savior. Listen, I'm telling you, it's the best decision you'll ever make. It's the greatest thing that'll ever happen in your life. God loves you. Hey, listen, he loved you so much that he sent his only begotten son to die on Calvary's cross for you. He didn't die for his own sin. He died for my sin. He died for your sin. And today he's saying to you right now, listen, he's saying, hey, choose the right path. Choose me. I'm the way, the truth, and life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. He's saying, hey, listen, I want you to choose me. Trust in me as your personal Savior. What will be your decision today? We're making a decision one way or the other. We've already decided to trust in Christ, or we're deciding to reject him. What will you do? Let's all stand with our heads bowed and eyes closed as we pray. Lord, we thank you and praise you. Lord, you've been so good. You've been so loving, so merciful, so gracious. Lord, we thank you that you're a loving God. And yet, God, we know that you are also a just and holy God. And God, our sin, it separates us from you. Lord, you've warned us in your word. You're trying to get our attention, Lord. You give us your word so that we can see how we can have a relationship with you. Not a religion where man tries to reach out to God, but where you reached out to us and you want a relationship. Lord, I pray that you would help us today to see what road we're on. Lord, I believe they're part of the many. There are many that are deceived. They think they're on their way to heaven. They hope they're on their way to heaven. But Lord, you don't want us to think or hope. You want us to know that we're on our way to heaven. Thank you for giving us verses in the Bible like, "These things have I written unto you that believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life." Lord, thank you for giving us that know-so salvation. Thank you for the peace that you give in my heart. Lord, I pray that you'd speak to hearts now. May we see ourselves as you see us. May we see vividly what road we're on. May we see vividly what group we're in. May we see vividly where we'll spend all eternity. Speak to us, Lord, I pray.